बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम एंड वेलकम टू अनदर लेक्चर ऑन सप्लाई चेन मॉडलिंग। वी वर ऑन मॉड्यूल टू, दैट इज फैसिलिटी लोकेशन डिसीजन, एंड इन द लास्ट लेक्चर लेक्चर 2-1 वी डिस्कस्ड सम मेथड्स टू लोकेट अ फैसिलिटी। सो वी डिस्कस्ड सेंटर ऑफ ग्रेविटी मेथड, द वेबर मेथड, द फैक्टर EHP analytic hierarchy process. In second part of this module, we are going to discuss multiple facilities location decision. So we will here build a mathematical model using mixed integer linear programming technique, and then we will solve that model using Microsoft Excel. So learning objectives of this lecture are to understand different factors impacting the decision of number of facilities, understand what is an LP and MILP model, linear programming and mixed integer linear programming model, and then use MILP to select multiple facilities locations and allocate capacities. So this model will actually be helping us to decide two things: select facilities among the available options and allocate capacities. So in the last lecture we discussed what is a facility. So facility is a nodal point in the supply chain network. So a facility could be a plant, it could be warehouses, it could be retail outlets, service centers, and so on. The goods temporarily stop on their way to final customers at these facilities. So there are four broad aspects related to facilities. So when we talk about facility design in supply chain, we are generally concerned with multitude of factors. The following are some important factors. So first one is the role of facility. So the facility that we are going to design, or for which we are going to select the location, its role is important to be known. So it could be a production facility, production plant, for example. It could be a warehouse where the things are stored. It could be a distribution center. It could be a retail outlet. It could be a service center, and so on. So that is the fundamental point to be considered, to be decided. That what is the role of the facility that we are going to build. The second important factor is number of facilities. For example, how many plants we are going to have in the supply chain, that is the production facilities, how many warehouses are going to be there, how many distribution centers, retail outlets, and so on. So number is very important. The third factor is facility location. So physically, where that specific facility or the number of facilities that we have decided will be actually located. And finally, capacity of facility. So if it is a production plant, what will be the production production capacity of that plant? If it is a warehouse or distribution center, what will be the, say, storage capacity of that distribution center or warehouse, and so on. So we discussed this aspect of facilities design, that is that is where the facility should be located, using different methods like center of gravity and Weber methods and factor rating method and EHP. We learn to decide the location of a facility, or to select a facility among available options. In today's topic, we are going to specifically address these two points: the number of facilities and capacity of facility. With respect to capacity, actually, we are not here going to decide what should be the capacity of a facility, but we will learn to allocate capacity from a certain plant to a certain demand point or a market. So we saw these points in the last lecture that are important to select the location of your facility. So one of them is proximity to source of supply, proximity to customers, access to utilities, labor availability and cost, transportation and distribution system, proximity to competitors, and so on. So factor rating method and AHP were used to rank these factors. Of course, they were not exactly these factors, but we had a number of factors. And secondly, to rank each facility with respect to these factors, and then rank each facility as a whole using a cumulative score. So there is a fundamental point that should be kept in mind, and that is the decision of facility location is linked to the business strategy of any organization. For example, if an organization is focusing on cost leadership, that is, it is a low cost provider, then its focus will be to find lowest cost location for manufacturing facilities, even if that means locating far from the markets they serve. So like in Lahore, you can see some of the garments manufacturing units. In contrast, firms that focus on responsiveness tend to locate facilities closer to the market to react quickly to changing market needs. And in this case, they might be choosing a facility that is closer to the customer, so that will be eventually expensive as well. So, but in order to achieve responsiveness, they can go for a relatively expensive facilities. So another related point is that the organizations that are willing to tolerate long response time, that is, that are focusing on low cost, require only a few locations. So number of facilities are few. So these companies can focus on increasing the capacity of each location. So the ultimate goal is on the effective utilization, maximum utilization of these facilities, and ultimately achieving the economies of scale. In contrast, firms that target customers who value short response time, that is, the organizations that are focusing on responsiveness, need to locate facilities close to the customers. So these firms generally have many facilities, so number of facilities is greater here, and capacity in each facility is relatively low. So this is just vice versa. So if you are looking for short response time, you may need more facilities so that you can approach as many customers as possible and reduce their response time. And for the organizations that are focusing on low cost, that is, they are tolerating long response time, they are having few facilities and maximum utilization of each facility. So the question is, how many facilities actually? And what is the relation of deciding the number of facilities with some important factors? So one point that is very obvious is that increasing the number of facilities will increase the facilities related cost. So for example, of course, if you are building more facilities, there will be higher fixed cost. More facilities also means that there will be higher operating cost. And this cost almost linearly increases up to a certain point. And beyond that point, this increase in cost is sort of very rapid. You can see this curve. So you can think what could be the reason of this exponential or very rapid increase in the cost of costs related to the facilities. But the basic point is very clear that increasing the number of facilities will increase the costs related to the building the facilities and running those facilities. Now, in the second graph here, we have actually number of facilities on y-axis. So that is quite obvious that increasing the number of facilities will reduce response time. And reducing the number of facilities will increase response time. So that is quite obvious that if we have more facilities, so we can easily access the customer, so the response time for the customer will be low, and vice versa. Third important factor is transportation cost. So here you can see that increasing the number of facilities does reduce the transportation cost, but up to some point. And beyond that point, as we saw in the case of facilities costs, the transportation cost starts to increase. We will discuss this point in detail when once we will discuss the module on logistics, because there are two types of costs that actually contribute to transportation costs. So one is the inbound cost and the other is outbound cost. So this increase in transportation cost actually will be more clear once we will discuss these two types of transportation costs. But up till a certain point, of course, the transportation cost reduces. And if we increase the number of facilities beyond that point, transportation costs starts to increase. So sort of diseconomies of scales has been reached at this point. So it's useless to increase the number of facilities beyond that point, or it will cost more to build and run facilities, and reduction in transportation cost will be correspondingly low. And another factor is inventory related costs. So if we increase the number of facilities, the inventory costs will also increase, and this increase is not linear, but up to some point this increase is more, and beyond that point this increase is less, and it may become flat at some point as well. And so again, once we will discuss the warehouse design and how to decide the number of warehouses, we will discuss this point in detail. That, for example, if we have one warehouse and we are keeping an inventory of 1,000 units, and if we decide to move from one warehouse to two, so the keeping other factors constant, the inventory held will not be just divided by two. It won't be just 1,000 divided by two, and that is 500 items at each facility. Rather, it will be more than 500 at each facility. So as a result, once inventory is increasing, so inventory cost is also increasing. But it doesn't depend only on the number of items, but it will also depend upon, of course, other costs related to building more facilities. Like you may require more staffing, you may require more material handling equipment, and so on. So in general, increasing the number of facilities will also increase inventory related costs. So these were a few important points related to number of facilities and how this decision is impacted by some important factors. Now we will start a discussion on our mathematical model, that is basically MILP, mixed integer linear programming model, and we will use it to select the best locations for facilities among available options. So similar to AHP and factor rating method, we will have some facilities available, and we will decide which combination is best under certain condition. In this case, we will also be given the capacity of these facilities. So these could be existing facilities for which we know the capacity, or these could be proposed facilities for which we have anticipated capacities. So these models, MILP models, have different variations. Two more common are capacitated and uncapacitated models. So we will focus on the capacitated MILP model for facilities location and capacity allocation. So let's suppose we have certain number of supply regions, for example, plants, and certain number of demand regions, let's suppose the markets. So for example, we have plants, or it could be any other supply region as well. Let's say it could be distribution center as well. And on the other side, we have the demand region. So for example, these are the markets. So we have say N plants or supply regions and M markets or demand regions. So I is the subscript for the plants and J for the markets. And there are different factors related to these supply regions or plants. For example, FI. So plants are designated as I. So FI is the fixed cost of building and or running the plant. So that is FI. So for example, F1 will be the fixed cost related to plant 1, F2 related to plant 2, and Fn related to plant N. Similarly, K denotes the capacity of each of these plants. So that means K1 will be the capacity of plant 1, K2 the capacity of plant 2, and K3 the capacity of plant 3. Similarly, each of these markets has a certain demand. So markets are designated with subscript J. So each of these markets will have a certain demand. So let's call it D subscript J. So sorry, the first one will be D1, and then D2, and so on. So demand in general is D subscript J. So for first market, it will be D1, D2, up to DM. Now, in this case, the model that we are discussing, each plant can supply to each market under certain constraints. So for example, plant 1 can supply to market 1, it can supply to market 2, it can supply to market M as well. And same is true for plant 2, it can supply to market 1, it can supply to market 2, and so on. So I'm not drawing all arrows here, but I hope the concept is clear. So let's suppose plant 1 supplies certain quantity to market 1. So that quantity is designated as XIJ. So the quantity is designated as X. So XIJ shows quantity supplied from plant I to market J. So for example, in the case of quantity supplied from plant 1 to market 1, it will be X11. From plant 1 to market 2, it will be X12. From plant 2 market 1, X21. And from plant 2 to market 2, it will be X22, and so on. And Cij is the cost of transporting one unit of the demand from plant I to market J. For example, it could be a truckload, it could be certain other units like a ton or certain volume. So that is the cost of delivering that one unit of demand from plant I to market J. So for example, it will be C11, cost of transporting that one unit load from plant 1 to market 1, C12 from plant 1 to market 2, C21 from plant 2 to market 1 and C22 from plant 2 market 2 and so on. So this is the basic graphical model. So you must keep the basic notation in your mind. So I1 to N shows number of plants, J1 to M shows the markets, fixed cost of building or running the plant, capacity of each plant, Ki, Xij, quantity transported from plant I to market J, and Cij, cost of transporting unit load from plant I to market J. Okay. So we have seen this already, just I will very quickly go through it. Cij, cost of producing and shipping. So I verbally told you it is cost of just shipping, but it could also include the production cost. So cost of producing and shipping one unit from plant I to market J. It could include production cost, inventory cost, and transportation cost. Fi is the fixed cost of constructing and or running plant I. One thing that I didn't mention was that we have to decide whether or not plant I should be constructed or run or not. So that is variable Yi. So it's a binary variable. So that is why we are calling it to be mixed integer linear programming model, because it is a binary or integer variable. So if we decide to construct or run a plant, then next decision is how much should be shipped from plant I to market J. So that is Xij. So Ki was the capacity of plant I, and Dj was the demand of market J. Okay, so what is the objective function? That is to minimize the total cost. The objective function. So that is to minimize the total cost, and total cost is sum of variable cost and fixed cost. So total cost is fixed cost plus variable cost. So what is the fixed cost? That is, as we saw, Fi for plant I and Yi. So if Y is zero, then this fixed cost will also be zero, because we are not opening that specific plant, but this Yi, if it is one, then it will simply multiply by the relevant fixed cost. So it applies to all our plants from 1 to n. And what is the variable cost? So that is, as we saw, Cij, cost of producing and transporting one unit load to market J from plant I, multiplied by the relevant quantity. So it applies to all plants, because each plant can supply to each market as well as to each of the markets. So from J1 to M. So that is our objective function, to minimize the total cost, and that is the sum of fixed cost and variable cost. Fixed cost is constructing and running the plant, and variable cost is cost of producing and transporting from plant I to market J. Then we have, this is just the statement of this objective function, to allocate demand from different markets to the various plants to minimize the total cost of facilities, transportation, and inventory. So next we have constraints. So one of the constraints is that all demands are to be met at all markets. So that is the demand constraint. The second constraint is total quantity supplied by a plant cannot exceed its capacity. So that is the capacity constraint. The third is the quantity supplied cannot be negative. So that is non-negativity constraint. And the fourth one that is not mentioned here is actually the binary constraint, that this yi could be either 0 or 1. So let's write these four constraints mathematically now. So first we have the demand constraint. Demand constraint. So the quantity xij supplied from all plants that are opened, of course, I is equal to 1 to n to a certain market j should be equal to its demand, that is dj, right? So that means that all the sum of all quantities supplied from plant 1 to n to the market d subscript j should satisfy its demand. So that is why we are writing it equal to d subscript j. So if we rearrange, that will become d subscript j, the demand for a market j minus this xij, sum of xij's should be equal to 0. So that is our first equation. So you need to have these equations with you once we solve this in Excel. The second constraint is the capacity constraint. So that constraint is that the quantity xij supplied by a certain plant to different markets, that is J1 to M, should be less than or equal to the capacity of that plant. So that means that total quantity supplied by any plant to different markets cannot exceed its capacity. The capacity will be greater than or equal to what is being supplied. So if we rearrange, that will become KIYI minus XIJ. So capacity minus total quantity supplied by this plant I. So capacity minus total quantity supplied by this plant I to all markets from 1 to n should be greater than or equal to 0. Right? So we can have this equation means that we can have the surplus capacity because it is greater than or equal to 0. So we can have extra capacity. But in first constraint, we are given that we are not supplying more than the demand. So that is where that is equal to 0. Okay, very quickly, the third constraint was the binary constraint. So yi will be equal to 0 or 1. And finally, the quantity supplied from plant I to market j should be positive. The quantity cannot be negative. So keep these four equations and objective function with you. We will need them when we solve this model in Excel. So this was our objective function, this one, and these are four constraints. So in the next segment, we will solve this model in Excel. Thank you very much.